All right, it's 2 o'clock. Welcome everyone. So this event is, this is two events right now. This is another session of a criminology elective I'm teaching here at USM called Crim 217, Crime and Justice in Maine. It's also a public lecture, you know, conveniently titled Conversations in Crime and Justice in Maine. And today we are welcoming Adan Abdikadar and Skye Gosselin of Maine Youth Justice. If you've been, you know, following the news in the past couple of years in the state of Maine, you've probably heard about the Long Creek Development Center, the last youth prison in the state of Maine. There's been, you know, investigations and bills and vetoes and, you know, lots of activity around Long Creek. And, you know, Maine Youth Justice has been one of the main actors, you know, in those politics. So this talk is sponsored by the USM Criminology Department with support from CCD, the Center on Collaboration and Development here at USM. I'm going to, you know, this is a set up as a conversation. So I'm going to, you know, read the short bios of Adan and Skye from Maine Youth Justice's website. Then I'm going to ask some questions, and then we'll open it up to Q&A from the audience. So let's start with Adan. Adan is a 22-year-old youth activist and youth organizer. He was born in Nairobi, Kenya, but has lived in Lewiston, Maine for the past 16 years. He got into youth activism through the theater group Maine Inside Out. He is currently a project facilitator for Maine Inside Out, an organization that utilizes theater to capture community's attention and educate on the subject of incarceration. He is a youth organizer with Maine Youth Justice. And this organization addresses the failures of the criminal juvenile justice system while also working to advance reform. Skye Gosselin is a 22-year-old youth activist and community organizer for Maine Youth Justice. She's from Biddeford, Maine. She currently runs the political education team. She was one of the first youth organizers for MYJ. She is now on full-time staff and works every day to change how things currently are in Maine. She is also enrolled at USM for political education and hopes to further her education after graduation. Well, it's great to have you, Skye and Adan. Welcome, and you know, thanks for being here. So we'll start with just, you know, a general background question. Can you tell, you know, for those of us who aren't familiar, can you just tell us a little bit about Maine Youth Justice, the fight to close Long Creek, and, you know, how the two of you became involved in this work?
Yeah. Adan, do you want to say what Maine Youth Justice is? Want to kick it off?
Yeah, I mean, I could just say a little bit. Maine Youth Justice is a youth-led campaign. Maine Youth Justice is a spread like all around Maine. Well, with youth that we work with from cities like Lewiston, Biddeford, Portland. I can talk about like how I became involved. I became involved by going to in-person meetings, protests and events, and also supporting bills, you know, going to testify at the state house. I enjoyed speaking up for, you know, what was right and for what I believed in. It brought me joy, you know, to be a part of people that were united and had a mission to make a change. The way I brought the campaign life was I went out to the community. You know, I got people like my peers to get involved, and I educated folks on the harm that incarceration brought to people. You know, I reached out to system impacted folks, and I made them aware of people who wanted to help them and their families. We provided a way for the people to have voices and presenting them, you know, how we are stronger together by showing them ways to be heard. Getting the whole Maine Youth Justice thing started. It started off being a part of the theater group, Maine Inside Out. You know, we wanted a way to like actually feel like we were doing something. We felt we wanted to feel like we were doing something for our peers that were on the inside. We just didn't think that, you know, creating plays and going on stage and sharing our stories was enough. So what we decided to do was like, let's think of something that really gets us to start going, you know, and Maine Youth Justice was created. And I felt like when I saw the work that Maine Youth Justice was doing, I was like, yo, this is it. Like, this is what I want to do. I want to be there for those that are locked up. My friends, I don't want people to, you know, not know what they're walking into when they get in trouble. So I started educating myself and others, and I'll pass it on to Skye.
Yeah, thank you, Adan. So me and Adan started it together. So he basically said a lot of how we started Maine Youth Justice, and we're both in Maine Inside Out together and both have different experiences in the system in different ways, especially because he's from Lewiston, I'm from Biddeford. You know, that's two different areas, but still have been severely impacted by the justice system from Long Creek, especially. I was incarcerated when I was younger, and you know, Long Creek didn't do anything for me, and I was just so lost. And like, once you go inside of Long Creek, it's automatically like your childhood is taken away. You're essentially, they call it a development center, but it's essentially a juvenile prison. That's the conversation we should be having, is about locking kids up, and that's what Long Creek is. And when I was in there, there was about 200 kids roughly. And you could see it was just mainly Biddeford, Portland, Lewiston, the places that were had more people, obviously. But, you know, I got involved in Maine Inside Out. And that was the time where I started to find myself and started to understand more, because in my community, I wasn't ever committed, but everyone I knew was committed. So I was alone in my community, and there was no supports there for me until I had found Maine Inside Out and started having conversations with other people who had the same experiences as me, the same different ways that they were impacted. And we just started sharing our stories, and then we got to put it in plays. Because when she like had those feelings, it's so hard to express those. And we found art was the best way to express what was actually going on. So I've been a part, I think me and Adan have both been a part of like 6 plays, I believe. And they have so many different topics. We had like topics on poverty, homelessness, racism, sexism, ageism. Ageism is a big one, right? Especially as young people being activists in Maine. You know, a lot of adults don't believe us, but we believe that young people with direct experience are the experts on what they need. So with that, we got to travel to Washington, D.C. and perform at the Capitol and got to spread out. We've been to the Augusta. We've met with lawmakers, including the head of the Department of Corrections. We got to talk with the governor. And with all that, we decided we needed to do something more. So that's where, as Adan was saying, Maine Youth Justice got developed. And so we started going around, and we created a bill 2 years ago called LD 1668. And that bill was to essentially close down Long Creek. We'll create a plan to close down Long Creek by 2023 and transition the kids out and create community-based alternatives, which is like places so they can have housing programs, so they can be in the community and stay in the community. Because Long Creek is located in South Portland, and as we were talking about, a lot of these kids come from a lot of different areas. Maine is huge. So a lot of these kids were ripped away from their communities. So community-based alternatives would keep them in the community. So with that bill, we had so many people coming on, testifying, talking about Long Creek, and it got passed the House and the Senate. And then Janet Mills, unfortunately, vetoed it. We'll probably get into that a little bit later. But so right now, kind of like what we're doing a little bit is going to be putting out another bill as well. And so that's what we've been kind of doing, and where Maine Youth Justice kind of came on in like 1,000 words or less. I could talk for days about it.
Okay, thank you so much. That was a great first answer. So now we're going to get kind of into some of the specific issues. You know, in 2020, the Center for Children's Law and Policy assessed Maine's juvenile justice system One of the key takeaways was that 53% of the young people detained at Long Creek that year did not pose any public safety risk. Instead, they could not go home for any number of reasons, like absent parents or mental health needs, or alternative placements that did not have room for them. So you mentioned, you know, about community-based alternatives. I wonder if you could just speak a little bit more about that. How does Maine Youth Justice propose meeting the needs of these children so they don't have to be at Long Creek?
Yeah, well, if kids are being detained in Long Creek because the alternatives do not have room. So a lot of these programs, a lot of the times they don't have enough beds or secure placement for them, or just not enough programs in Maine. And so a lot of these kids get put in placement in Long Creek. And what we see happen is the longer time they spend in Long Creek, a lot of the times they're introduced to more harm, introduced to more trauma, and you're just kind of locking them away. And a lot of times they get forgotten about or get new charges inside. So we're kind of creating a pattern of more arrests and more criminal, more criminal activity on it because of like just being detained there. And instead of like putting them there in the first place, we should be looking at preventative care instead of punishment. And so it seems pretty straightforward that we need to create more beds and resources that actually have the training to meet young people's mental health care. And the answer to where the money going to come from to fund these beds, it really could be as simple as to ending detainment and incarceration at Long Creek and reallocating the operating budget, which is $18.5 million right now, into a new fund that can be reinvested into communities. And as we know right now, there's about 20 to 27 kids at Long Creek. So that means we're spending $18.5 million to detain 27 kids. And like right now, the problem is in Maine that the money is tied into the building in Long Creek itself. So why we're trying to make the bill is because Maine Youth Justice needs to, we believe that the money should be divested from the building and like reinvest the funds into resources so Maine youth can have these things and have the housing programs and things built. So in our new bill, what we're going to be asking for is a transition plan and a plan to help create these programs, kind of like a pilot program. So we're not just letting them out and having nothing for them to go to. There's going to be like a slow little process of having them come out. So not all at once, there's nothing there because that wouldn't be helpful either. So having them come out, having programs built, and it wouldn't just be run by the department, having different entities also help run that program as well. Aiden, I don't know if you wanted to jump in on any of that.
Yeah, I mean, you know, how do we meet these needs? I say like installing people instead of, you know, it being a prison, instead of it being a jail cell that you put these kids in, it's a place where they actually get support, where they get one-on-one credible messengers that know what they need, that know what it's like being in the system and actually trying to, you know, develop these kids. You know, you call it a development center, but you know, what kid comes out really, you know, having pluses coming out of the, you know, the facility? You know, what kid do you see coming out of Long Creek and saying, it was the best thing that happened to me? Never heard of. So I'm like, what really needs to happen is this money needs to be invested in things that really work. And that's hands-on work. You know, people say, you know, there's not enough jobs. There's not enough people that want to work in a prison. I mean, who would want to lock kids up if you really think about it? You know, and still people that will bring them back to the communities, help them realize, you know, the mistakes they made, develop their lives, and actually make them successful in life to change their mindsets and how they really move in life, instead of, you know, harming them and locking them away and then coming back, having to catch up with folks, their peers, their family members who've all already moved on and just forgot about them. So really what I would say is, put the money where it's supposed to be, in the communities, you know, develop the communities.
Great, thank you. So let's talk about Janet Mills and the vetoed bill in 2021. She called the measure fundamentally flawed because it forces the closure of the state's only secure confinement option for juvenile offenders before safe and appropriate alternatives will be available. So I wonder, you know, what is your response to this decision? And then specifically, what would you say to people who think secure confinement is the only responsible option to deal with youth that have, you know, committed violent offenses? I think a lot of people are quite sympathetic to the 53% that we talked about before, the people that are just there because there aren't other resources. But what would we say to people, or what would you say to people who are much more hesitant to move beyond Longfeet Creek when they think of violent offenders?
What I would say to those people is that, you know, those people, I don't think know how it feels. Those people, I don't think understand how much they forgot that they're human. You know, we don't do that to humans. We won't do it to our pets. We won't do it to humans. We don't lock people away, especially children. And what I say to what Janet Mills did, vetoing the bill to close Longcreek, is that, you know, basically right in our faces is saying that we're not going to listen to the community. We don't believe that this place is creating harm when you know that it does. What I see from it is that you don't care about, you know, our youth and our communities and our, you know, tax. I mean, all you care about is our tax dollar bills. If we really look at it, how it's coming, it's all about the money. You're basically saying there's too much money tied down into this building that's, you know, yearly, you know, funding. And it's like, where's all this money going? You know what I'm saying? And what you're saying is that it's basically impossible because it's a machine of money and a machine of constant, you know, repetitive harm that people are turning a blind eye to. And there you go. And I would say, like, honestly, you know, with kids, when it comes to kids, like, you know, they could always change. You know, these young people deserve a second chance, you know, and we acknowledge that, you know, young people have the capacity to do, you know, harmful things, but we also believe that young people have the capacity to repair harm caused, you know, repair the harm that they caused and create change, you know, because they're part of the future, and it's not fair for us to snatch it away and say that you don't deserve one, you know?
Yeah. And, you know, kids can always change, and these young, as Adan was saying, these young people deserve a second chance. And you can't fight violence with violence to stop violence, right? So that's kind of what secure confinement is. And you can name it all these different words, but it is, you're putting them behind locked doors, and they just are not prepared to deal with them either. And, you know, Maine Youth Justice acknowledges that young people have the capacity to do harmful things, but we also believe that young people have the capacity to repair harm that caused and to change it. And sending a 13 and 14 year old to prison and bonding them to the adult system is not justice. So we need to figure out a way where we can, I think I mentioned it earlier, with like preventative care other than punishment. The system is doing exactly how the system is built, on punishment to oppress. And we need to come up with a different system that isn't just, you did something wrong, you need to be punished. We need to ask the question, why is this happening? What is the environment that's happening? Because if you do research on a lot of these young people, their environment itself is harmful, so they're gonna be acting up. And a lot of these times, these kids are just, it's a cry for help because they wanna be heard, they wanna be listened to, and they wanna be loved and cared for. And we're not doing that if we're just sending them to jail to, it should just being like, you know what, you come from this area, you don't have the money to get you out either. Because if you think about the environments, different environments, some kids can do the same exact crimes. You have two different kids from two different environments. One kid's going to be let free and one kid's going to go to jail. That's just how it works. That's just how America has always done it. And we just need to give them the second chance. And that's our right, our thing that we need to do. We need to do that by building these community alternatives, by building the programs and listening to these kids, because these kids know what they're talking about. They know what they need. We just have to open our ears and listen to it.
Thank you so much for those, you know, very clear and powerful answers. So, you know, now we're going to move on from the veto to, you know, the what reforms the state has put forward. So, you know, the governor vetoed the 2021 bill that would have set a 2-year, that would have closed Long Creek this year. But a new law passed that prevents anyone from 12 or younger from being locked up at the facility. The Maine Department of Corrections also created two transitional homes, which are staffed by social workers and teachers, as well as the juvenile equivalent of corrections officers. They also created three regional care teams where representatives from state agencies and local service providers meet once a month to review individual cases and work together to meet the needs of the young person in question. So I wonder, what is Maine Youth Justice's position on these reforms? Are they enough? Are they something to build on? Are they counterproductive in some way? What do you say about the Maine Department of Corrections efforts so far?
Yeah. So I guess like my question is just like, what is the definition of reform, right? Reform puts a band-aid on something that we know doesn't work. And that's kind of how I picture these transitional houses. Just because we call it therapeutic or call it something else doesn't mean it doesn't feel the same. The building itself is going to change, but if you bring the new guards over, you bring the new training over and you do all this stuff, it's going to be the same with a different name. That's why how they can get away with calling it a transition youth development center and not a youth prison is because it sounds different. And it just, you know, feel like people are going to be okay with that in the community because they don't know. And that's what they get on by, right? And again, the system is built on punishment and these transitional homes are secure confinement, which isolates them even more. And young people are still gonna be under the power of the Department of Corrections, which means the money will be staying with the Department of Corrections. And we won't be seeing the appropriate needs these kids have fulfilled under the Department of Corrections. They have proven time and time again that they don't have the expertise on what these young people actually need. The only people who have these expertise are the people who have experienced the lack and harm of the system and know what they needed instead. And also, like, I'm going to put a link later for you guys to read, but there we got a letter from the Department of Justice. So the Supreme Court decision in Olmstead and versus Long Creek announced that it has concluded that Maine unnecessarily segregates children with mental health and or developmental disabilities in psychiatric hospitals, residential treatment facilities, in a state-operated juvenile detention facility. And the Olmstead decision held that people with disabilities have a right to live and receive services in the most integrated settings appropriate to their needs, typically in their homes and communities instead of institutions. And right now we know that 90% of the kids in Long Creek have three or more mental health disabilities. And so where I'm just asking where the data is for that, that how they're being treated and what is the, like, how are they being treated if they're in jail? Because we know that it's not being properly funded. Maine overspends for incarcerating youth, but underspends severely when it comes to mental health. And we know that this came from the Department of Justice. So, and then data is not being kept up on. And during the whole COVID process, they were also isolating these kids and putting them in 23-hour a day lockdowns. So, which even further goes on to their mental health. And I only said three or over three, but we know that that can be a lot more. Like, can you imagine being locked in your room for 23 hours a day and being only allowed to go to the bathroom when you ring your buzzer to go out, or when you have to get food being told to, you can't watch TV, you have books that are chosen for you, things like that. That's a conversation. Aiden, did you want to say anything?
Yeah, I mean, just like the fact that this whole, you know, transformative like justice, like, and restorative justice, like you're repeating the same thing, but like giving it to us in a different way. Like, we asked for you to, you know, reintegrate these youth back into the communities. Instead, what you do is you make outside, you know, type home cells that you put outside of the facility, but it's not within, it's not outside of the fences. So it's really like, what makes sense to that of us asking for one thing and you giving us another, and basically saying that no, they don't belong back into the communities, they still belong here. And it's like these little words that they use on us and these words that they describe these places to be, you know, are they true? Are they exactly what you say they are? We're not in there. And when these kids come out, they're not the same.
Thank you. So you both alluded to, you know, violence and abuse and harm at Long Creek, you know, and this has been a consistent finding, a consistent problem. In 2017, the National Center for Children's Law and Policy criticized the use of prone restraints at Long Creek. In 2021, Disability Rights Maine found that Long Creek staff were still using prone restraints. And of course, there's a current lawsuit working its way through the courts over the use of solitary confinement at Maine's juvenile justice system. Earlier this month, Maine Department of Corrections Commissioner Randy Liberty spoke as part of the speaker series. He claimed that solitary confinement has been eliminated, and he blamed prone restraints on staffing shortages that were causing COs to be overworked and stressed out. At a recent budget hearing, he cited staffing shortages to defend the proposed increase in Long Creek's budget from $16.3 million to $18.1 million. What are your responses to these issues? Can excessive force be reformed out of the system?
Aiden, do you want to take this one?
Yeah. I mean, I would say no, I don't think so. I don't think that prone restraint can be reformed out of the system, because these are things that they are trained to do in their trainings. You know, teachers are overstaffed and stressed out. Their stress would not justify the use of prone restraint. Can't blame kids for being in survival mode while being isolated and detained. I mean, they are stressed out and put into a setting where physical abuse and reaction is the normal. And again, can't fight violence with violence, you know, to stop violence. Long Creek, you know, went down from 120 kids. Went from 120 down to 20 kids inside the facility. It doesn't make sense, you know, why you need more money for less people. And then you're going to keep asking for money, waste the citizens, you know, all this money that the citizens are putting into this facility. And then you're continuing to harm kids. And then it's like our tax dollars are going into violent institution. And then save money by, you know, creating resources that are rooted into preventive care, you know, like let us help you, honestly. Let the community help you. Let the community be responsible for, you know, the youth that we create, and let us be responsible for how we, you know, discipline them. Give me one thing that's therapeutic about prone restraint or isolation or, detainment. You know, I'm saying, like, who would volunteer to want to be detained? Like, who would volunteer to be isolated and in prison? You know, let's just be real. You know what I'm saying? Those folks that are walking in to get dressed up and wear badges and come and, help detain youth and help, you know, say, rehabilitate youth. You know what I'm saying? Like, would you volunteer yourself to switch places with these youth? And that's what I'm saying. Like, why do you need prone restraints? Why do you need to treat a child that hard in order for them to be stopped? You know, I just sometimes don't get it. And then, you know, like, while MYJ has been, you know, mostly focused on Long Creek, the campaign has a larger agenda for the juvenile justice system. You know, what is NYJ's critique of the current juvenile justice system? What is your vision for an alternative system? You know, like, we're an abolition campaign. We're trying to end it in general. You know, like, we just don't want kids to be in prison. I don't believe prison should exist in general.
Yeah, and the thing on the question before was just, you know, I think I want to keep reiterating, you can't stop violence with violence. And, you know, think about the size of these kids, and they just put in this bill, but when I was there 5 years ago, there was 11-year-olds, there was 12-year-olds, there was young, and it goes all the way up to 21 too. So these guards are a lot of times huge, a lot of times they have training in how to restrain, but why do you need so many different prone restraints and on these small kids? And think about what a prone restraint is. If you've heard about the George Floyd, that's basically the way a prone restraint is, when they are on the back and then they are on them. So that's like how they restrain them. And if we're talking about doing that to these kids inside, like you can't control them. And as Adan said, it went down from to 120 to 20 kids. Why do you need more money or more people to take care of 27 kids? That just doesn't really make sense to me on that. And I just want to know in any of this conversation, what sounds therapeutic about prone restraints, isolation, or detainment? Because if that's the conversation that the OC is trying to have to go into there, it's going to be the same thing. They're still going to know their first automatic thing to train is prone restraints. And because they're understaffed, I don't think they're doing a big background on the guards that are going in there as well. So who knows what kind of guards are going in there too. And, you know, we have teachers who are overstaffed and stressed out, but their stress would not justify the use of prone restraint.
Great, thank you. So I wonder if you can update us. There's another legislative session happening. And I wonder what's Maine Youth Justice working on now? And, you know, if there's any students or, you know, people on the call that are interested in supporting your work or the organization's work, you know, what can they do?
Yeah. So as I mentioned earlier, I feel like I've said that like 10 times today. It's such a conversation where you kind of just repeat yourself. And because there's so many, it's like, so just to get like through people, it's just like, you know, these are the things happening. But yeah, we're creating a bill right now. We're waiting on the LD number. And once how like that whole thing works, the advocacy, it happens so slow and then all of a sudden it's so fast. So right now we're in the process of creating the bill and working with people, our coalition partners around the state, which include like lawyers, which include other abolitionist groups, which include, you know, some educators, things like that, to create this bill. And once it goes through, we're going to be doing a call to action, and we're going to be having a volunteer orientation. So anybody who's interested in learning more, we're going to be posting on our website, or you can sign up for our newsletter. And we're going to be talking about what the advocacy is, what a bill, what's the purpose of a bill, and what it will do, and how you can get involved with that, whether it's just small ways can get involved, whether it's helping with transportation to get organizers to the state house, whether it's writing an op-ed, whether it's writing a letter to the editor, whether it's testifying yourself, or just outreaching and getting people you know that might have experience or want to help as well. Anything like that will be helpful. And we're also going to be doing a social media blast, which is going to, there'll be like a toolkit on who your legislators are in your district as well, because there's going to be like Portland, Lewiston, all these different areas, and to just like find out who to call on that. But the biggest thing to find out all of that is to follow us on social media, because we'll be posting about that. And if you look on our website, you can follow us on the newsletter as well.
Is Grayson Luckner sponsoring the bill?
Yes. Yes, he is. He's sponsoring it again. And he's the one that also sponsored our last bill. So he's awesome. And he is going to be there. Yeah.
Great. Good to know. And then last, I just had, just a question about, a question, for, I suppose, for my students. You know, many of my students major in criminology out of a, you know, earnest desire to make a career of helping, you know, so-called at-risk youth. What advice would you offer to these students? Should they pursue careers in corrections or juvenile justice? Were there any other options that they should be thinking about?
Yeah, I think, you know, can do your own research on what the difference of how, what career you pursue will actually benefit the kids or harm the kids too. I think those are a lot of things to think about, especially when you hear like kind of corrections. Corrections in itself can be like, you know, a Long Creek guard or something like that. Or, you know, I think also what can be helpful in education is joining groups like Maine Youth Justice or other abolitionist groups to finding out more research or having one-on-one conversations with youth who have been in the system or just know. I think just getting yourself out there and finding what's going on in Maine. And also, if you don't want to stay in Maine, there's so many different abolitionist campaigns across the country as well. Maine Youth Justice was created on a thing called Youth First. I can drop their thing in the website, but they have a lot of different campaigns that across the country as well. And one other really good educational website is called Critical Resistance. I'll drop that as well for you guys. There's a lot of things I was gonna, one of my major things, I was gonna print it all for you guys so you have a handout when I came, just to have all the things, because that's kind of how I got into this position as well, just having the experience, but also just educating, YouTube research, like, what is the difference of reform? What is the difference of abolition? What is defund? What is all these different things? It's really good to hear, like, know clearly what the conversation is about too, and to make your own political analysis of what it is. And do you want to say anything, Adan, on there?
Yeah, I mean, just talk to people. I mean, talk to folks that are in the work right now. Also, just, you know, educate yourself, you know, on the DOC, and then educate yourself on juvenile justice, you know, what it really is and what the work holds. And just get different perspectives, you know, different side, there's different roles and all different roles and different sides of the work. And it's like, especially if you're going to be working on youth, DOC or youth, like anything that has to do with young people, just knowing or remembering, like, when you were young or what you used to do. And then if you're going to implement it into your work, just educate yourself before, you know, just diving in.
Thank you. So we have over a half hour for questions. You know, if you have a question for the speakers, feel free to, you know, raise your hand or put it in the chat. All right, here's a question from Emily Schaefer. A lot of people, when faced with discussions of decreasing Long Creek's budget, argue that it is impossible for a system or institution to improve itself when its budget is being cut. How would you approach this issue of people being resistant to budget cuts?
Well, I think the main goal is to make the institution itself go away. So I think, you know, that's what we're talking about with the Long Creek, right?
Yeah.
Yeah. I think, you know, I think the whole goal is to, you know, reallocate the funds and make sure it goes into the community. With Long Creek being tied, like the money being tied into Long Creek, you kind of have to get rid of that building. And the major thing that we're pointing out is making sure the money goes with the young people too. So there's so many more programs that can be made in the communities other than just having it tied into the building. And there's a lot, like, if we're also talking about, you know, job opportunities as well, we understand that a lot of these people have jobs in these places too, but there could be different job opportunities that is roles, it's like helping the continuum of care for young people instead of like harming them and doing more. You know, I think there's a lot more money that can also be made in the community that's not just with this Long Creek. There's like different ways, like, so the mental health will gain more money, the education, because I think right now Maine only spends like $13,000 per kid for education, while Long Creek spends $365,000 to incarcerate one youth. So it's just like, that's a major gap. Like, our whole goal is to have these kids like be in the communities, strive, know how to do, get a job. Like, because a lot of times when these kids are incarcerated right now, right, that's when the major part of their life, getting a first job, getting a bank account, driving, getting their license, getting their first apartment, applying for colleges, all these things. You know, when you are going away and then you just get all of a sudden pushed back, you don't know any of that. And all of a sudden you're 21 years old and have never had a life experience in that sense. And then all of a sudden you're just introduced to adulthood, right? So a lot of times these kids slip back. So we want to prevent that and have programs that'll actually help them succeed and be successful at it, instead of just knowing, like assuming that it'll be like the school to prison pipeline type thing, right? And, you know, because when I wasn't as successful in school the first time when I had just got out of Long Creek, I had all these goals, but I thought I could just jump right into college right away. And it just didn't work because like all these kids had already like done a lot of things and knew how to like go to class on time, go to get their own food, go to work, go do this. When you have a place like Long Creek that are constantly telling you, this is when you wake up, this is when you go take a shower, this is when you get your food brought to you, this is when you go to school, this is when you do that. What are you learning? Nothing. You're just learning a routine that somebody else has given to you. So a lot of times it's unsuccessful, but it ran over to bring it back to the building itself. I think the money itself should go with the kids and out of the institution itself.
Yeah. I would say how would you approach it? I would say, just ask them, like, is the budget to keep the lights on, or is it to rehabilitate those that have, you know, messed up? You know, like, is this money to make sure that these kids, you know, make a difference and learn, you know, from their mistakes? Or is it just to keep these lights on and these, you know, people to continue have jobs, you know? And it's like, our country is like number one in incarcerating people. So it's like, how many times, like, when are we going to realize that it's not working and that it's not, you know, showing folks that it's not teaching them a lesson, it's not rehabilitating them, it's not really doing much?
Okay, so Skye's comment reminded me of, you know, one of the classic works of the sociology of punishment is this book written by Irving Goffman, who, you know, observed prisons and asylums and stuff in the 50s and 60s. And his comment was, what do these total institutions produce? They produce people who are habituated to living in total institutions, who are used to, as Skye said, like, this is when you get up, this is when you shower, this is when you eat, you know? And those skills, surviving those institutions, are not the same skills as surviving outside, as you put it so nicely. Any other questions? We've got plenty of time. Yeah, John Butts, please unmute and ask your question. And then we'll go to Megan Weiss's question in the Q&A. You're muted, John. You need to mute your camera. There you go, or your mic.
All right, sorry.
No problem.
I'm a member of the Friends of Long Creek, which has been working with the kids at Long Creek for many, many years, 30 or so. And to say that the kids are regimented as much as has been talked about, you get up, you do this, you do that. Well, in fact, the kids have high school availability and they have to go to high school and they have classes. Also, we provided culinary arts school within Long Creek, as well as small engine repair, many other things to do. And it's not like they're all regimented and you can't do anything. Of course, they are in an enclosed environment. You have to have some order. That would include when you eat and so on and so forth. But to say the kids are mistreated is kind of an insult to the staff who work very hard at putting the ball into the kids' court. They have opportunities they can take advantage of. We even have a college program for them. They take college classes. We have people that will get them set up to go to college, apply for them, get them financial aid. So, you know, I'm not saying that Long Creek is an expensive proposition, but on the other hand, you are always going to have some kids that have to be incarcerated because of the nature of their crimes. And that's the Long Creek and the Justice Department of Corrections has done a lot in mitigating the number of kids that are incarcerated. Now it is just strictly kids that haven't been adjudicated and kids that may have committed I don't want to say heinous, but make them a danger to society. That's about it.
Yeah, thank you for sharing that. I mean, they could also benefit from them being on the outside too. I think, you know, they have the opportunities if they were in their community to also go to school, to also get cooking classes, to also have college and all that, and also not have trauma from being incarcerated. Because I have experience in there, you know, even just from being detained a long time, you get labeled as a bad kid and you have to go through life knowing that. And there are people that work there that do good, but they're also working for a system who also punishes them. Being overstaffed, being overworked is also not a good field for them either. So we aren't putting anything on the workers there and the people who are trying to help them, but the system overall is designed to not help them succeed. It's designed to punish. Why can't we think of how we can spend this money and how we can help these kids before the crime gets to that point where we have to incarcerate and put them in the programs in the communities and have the communities help each other help keep our kids in there? Because we're also talking about 11, 12, 13-year-olds that are also introduced to 21-year-olds who have also done things as well. That's an introduction that they would have never made without the Long Creek in itself. So I think there's a lot of different opportunities and conversations that we can be having outside of Long Creek itself and exploring what that can look like, exploring what the Long Creek building itself can look like too. That can be open for community centers where they can have job opportunities to learn how to do that. That could be having different programs where they can learn how to get involved with college, having people come in and volunteer their time. How do you apply for college? How do you apply for housing? How do you apply for all these different things? So there's like different opportunities that we can think about other than just like Long Creek itself.
Brendan.
Okay, I'll get you on stack. We got another question. I think Adan, were you about to respond as well?
Yeah, I was just gonna say, I mean, yeah, definitely, you know, when you have like Skye said earlier, when you have to be pushed into adulthood, you know what I'm saying, where you have to decide, well, you can't decide whether you're going to be free or not, but now you have to make choices whether you make the best of your chances. You're not going home, you know what I'm saying? And you're not just going to sit in your cell and be nothing and deteriorate. You're going to go and make the best of the opportunity that you have, which is, yes, I could still learn. Yes, I could still play sports. Yes, I might not be able to see my family, but I'm going to do what I have to do in order to keep up. And when I get back into the community, I'm not left behind. Those are decisions that I have to make for myself. You know that for sure. You see in the inside that there are some that don't want to do it at all. There are some that want to do it. And then there are some that make the best of what they're given. But not all of them, you know, come out the way that you say, or not all of them are doing the way that you say. These are the things that, like Skye said, they build into the head where this is what either you do this or either you don't. And by you of deciding whether you do it or whether you don't is how the say facility or how the space that you are or the you know right where you are is how they treat you. You know, say if you say no and you don't want to go by the way they say you should go by, it's tough for you. But if you do go on and follow the lead of what they are giving to you, it's easy for you. The time will be good, it'll go by, you'll be back into the community. And it's like that right there. A child should not have to decide, but even the space that they're at makes them decide. It makes them give, you know, do what they can when they have to.
Great, thank you. So we have a question from Megan from a few minutes ago, and then we'll go to James. Megan put in the chat, what kind of events does Maine Youth Justice do to inform people about youth incarceration?
Yeah, I love that. So right now we're in like the advocacy season. I kind of call them seasons. But right now we're going to be doing a lot of like Zoom where we're going to be teaching that and then going right into the testifying and all that stuff. And hopefully, since it was kind of hard to organize right after COVID, and we were like, all right, how do we make it accessible to all of our organizers that are statewide and we can still do that? So we were doing a lot of like webinars. And we were doing like online events where people could get involved. But hopefully after the advocacy season, we're going to be doing a lot of in-person events. So we usually do like the Juneteenth events, and we partner with like Maine Inside Out and like Indigo Arts Alliance and different other organizations in Maine, in Portland. And then we also do a lot of different tabling events all around the state as well. So I'll be posting once we get a little bit more established on that, but I'll be posting on our website and on social media about different events. We're going to be hopefully hosting a community event in Portland that's going to invite anybody who wants to volunteer, learn more about it, or just like, you know, hang out and talk with people in Portland, and just invite everybody to have like a cookout, come and hang with us. We also have a lot of different artists who like to do like poetry, rap, singing, songs, all these different things. And they like to put on events as well. So we'll be doing that. But if it's just a conversations, we are always up for one-on-ones to talk more about these conversations as well. And I could post me and Aiden's email on there as well, so you guys can reach out if you have any more questions that we didn't get to, or just have anything on the top of your head. Like, we're always up for discussions and debates. We love a good debate too. I think those are always healthy as well.
Yeah, and collaborations, you know, with different organizations, you know, all over Maine, block parties here in Lewiston that we collaborate with Maine Inside Out, and also recovery connections, you know, having a, you know, also, you know, every law enforcement, you know, community people, activists, everybody just come out. And then also we do some tabling around the Maine where we go and we reach out to folks, you know, we set our table down, you know, put our little logo on there, and we let people walk by and we're like, hey, have you heard of Maine Youth Justice? Just, you know, make sure people are aware that we are around, and educating them that of what we do. And, you know, if they want to know and they don't want to know, we just, you know, let them be and take a, you know, like a, some, you know, flyers and stuff they could take with them to go see and just have around the house.
Great, thank you. I think now we'll go to James, and then after that, there's a question in the chat from Hadrian. James, do you want to unmute and ask your question? You're muted, James. Can you turn your mic on?
Well, you young people got to put up with these old coots. My wife, Barbara, and I are also members of the Friends of Long Creek, which is a nonprofit organization. And our interest isn't in the bricks and mortar of Long Creek. It's in the kids and helping the kids. And a lot of that is educational. And we're the folks that bring USM professors into Long Creek to give college level classes to the kids. And we do a lot of other things, music, and John mentioned the culinary arts, but I want to emphasize our interest is in the kids. And our great fear when the last bill was vetoed, we agreed with the veto. And the reason we did wasn't because we want to preserve the bricks and mortar, but we were scared to death that without an alternative, they would close Long Creek. And those kids, particularly violent offenders, who will always be there, that they would be sent to the adult system, which would be a disaster, or out of state, away from their families, to secure mental health facilities, because Maine doesn't have a secure mental health facility for youth, or to secure youth jails out of state. So that was our fear. And I hope that when you craft your new bill, you'll take that into account. But I also would encourage you all to take a tour of Long Creek. And most people don't realize when you walk down the main corridor at Long Creek, it looks more like a high school than it does a jail. And there are an awful lot of good people trying to do good work. My wife and I have been mentors at Long Creek for 25 years, as well as on the board of the Friends of Long Creek. So it would be very helpful for criminal justice students from USM to take a tour of Long Creek, and then you'd know much better what you're talking about. But I salute you all, and we're all interested in the same thing, which is the welfare of those kids. Thank you.
Yeah, thank you guys for the work. I just want to say it is good work that you guys are doing in there, and I appreciate you saying that we are talking about the kids, right? Essentially. And, you know, there's always going to be conversations about the building, what it looks like afterwards, but we have the same goals as to helping these kids in the first place. And, you know, I think, yeah, I would encourage you guys to go look down Long Creek. I also encourage that they give you the opportunity to have a conversation with one of the kids inside and ask them how they feel about being incarcerated in there as well. And just about everything going on. And, you know, they do deserve programs and, you know, college and things like that and all that. And, you know, part of our bill is also, I think I mentioned, was a pilot program. So that's going to have a lot of different stakeholders in Maine. So that'll be like judges, probation officers, young people with experience, the DOC, Department of Education, all these different entities coming together to create a plan. So when there is a transition plan, it won't be right away. There will be something in place for these kids to go to, or when things happen, because we know that things always happen in life. But how, if we look into the past and figure out how we can prevent that from happening and have the secure funds to be able to do that, I think is the first step. And then just figure out, all right, if something like that does happen, how can it be transformative instead of punitive? How can we come together for a conversation and help this kid? If that's the conversation of the day right now, is to actually help the kid, how can we do that in a safe way that's going to benefit the kid and us as a community, instead of just pushing them away and, you know, having them in there? Because with all these awesome things that are inside, with like the cooking and classes and stuff like that, we're still talking about a jail. So that's what we got to be still talking about.
Yeah, I mean, to respond to that, I would say, like, you know, them kids, they only have that for a certain amount of time. And I'm sure there's some of them that are going for, you know, they're going to be there and then they're going to go to the adult, you know, facility. You know, what happens when they go to the adult facility? You know, it's not the same way. It's not the, you know, the same amount of support. But I'm just saying, like, when they don't have that anymore, you know, where do they go back to? They go back to the community, and they feel as if right now they just been taken somewhere and they just got dropped off. You know what I'm saying? Even, for example, as in group homes, you know, those folks at the group home are only helping those folks till they turn 21 and then they go home. And then the other thing, I'm not saying that the work you do is only temporary. I don't know how far, you know, it goes from the facility, but you know, they have it for a certain amount of time and then they're back into the community. And now they have to, you know, go back to it and do all that alone. Not that I'm saying they need someone to hold their hand, but it's hard for someone to be gone for such a while and be used to such a routine, and then just end that routine and get back to having to do everything by themselves again. You know, that's hard, it's tough, and it's somewhat a little bit unfair too, you know. And when you say like tour the facilities, I mean, those are some of the tactics that people are using nowadays. You know, these are some of the tactics that us as a country, we use, and we make these buildings, you know, look welcoming. We make them look comfortable. We make them look like schools. You know, why is those kids that are going to this school looking building never coming home? You know what I'm saying? Why are they coming home more defensive, more differently, and more, you know, bold to do, you know, whatever it is that they, you know, do? And yeah, I mean, that's all I can say. It's like, somewhat to me, I feel as if it's a tactic to make this place seem as if it's not harmful, but it really is. And I do appreciate, you know, all the work that you and your folks do in the inside, but you know, the outside is not the same. You know, when they come back to the outside community, it's not the same.
All right, we have a question from Hadrian Hatfield, and then we'll go back to James. So Hadrian wrote, are there any ways that we as a community members can directly support youth who are currently incarcerated at Long Creek, or show solidarity while we're working at a cultural legislative level to shut it down entirely? right? So if what should people do who support, you know, Maine Youth Justice's legislative agenda? What can they do in the meantime to support the people incarcerated at Long Creek?
Yeah, I would just say right now, just kind of talking with folks about what you're hearing today and, you know, just kind of making people aware of Long Creek in itself and what's going on. Because I think a lot of people aren't even aware. And like, really, it's located in South Portland, right in the city of everything. When I was in Long Creek, I could see like planes going by and just wishing every day I could be on that plane getting out, right? Just like kind of talking about this, having more conversations to learn more too, whether it's me, Adan, anyone in MYJ, or other people that have been in the community as well, and just reaching out. And then finding different things, like for when the legislation comes up, again, coming to testify, even just hearing how to testify or hearing, like coming in and seeing what that's about, all that kinds of stuff, and finding other groups as well in Maine that also do work like ours too. I think just all overall, just finding different ways to get involved. And I think a lot of different things are on social media. There's a whole lot of YouTube videos too that I found and learned about, like just to educate myself on that sense. So I think it just starts with a conversation.
All right, we have time for another question or two. I think James wanted to go again.
Oh, this is Barbara Willie. And I too have been a mentor for many years and a member of the board of the Friends of Long Creek. I did want to let you know, first of all, I think the work you're doing is very positive and very helpful to the young people who are able to be released sooner to get back into the community. I would like to see, as we have mentors within the facility, communities begin setting up mentors, and it's going to take some work, but have mentors to be there to greet those youngsters as they exit and help them become stabilized so that the questions that you're asking, how do I cope? I've been on a regime. I haven't been able to really think for myself and have the time to consider what I'm going to have to do. I think that will be a huge part of helping each facility in the new communities that they're going to, their own hometowns, hopefully, begin to make it a positive experience for them, to be a kind of a counselor mentor for them, available whenever they need them, you know, to ease that transition. Thank you.
Yeah, totally, totally agree with that. One of the cool things that we were talking about as one of the pilot programs was a credible messengers type of situation. So like having, it's always been helpful to me when I got out was having somebody that I knew had experienced it and also overcame it, right, too, and seeing how they're doing now. Just like for me being able to have this experience, talking to you, all of you guys, and talking about my experiences and how I am more stable and how I learned to navigate all of that, and to be able to kind of like be a big sister, big brother program to come out and be like, all right, so this is how this works. And this is how this, any questions in that, somebody who has had past experience in that will have the best answers to give and be like, you know, especially when finding housing, they look at backgrounds. Cause a lot of times in Maine, we think that our backgrounds as juveniles get expunged, but they don't unless you ask for it. That's a whole other topic. But you know, a lot of times the only two letters show up as JV to make it different on your background check. So it's hard to get into housing. It was hard to get into USM at first too. I had to talk about my background as a juvenile to get into USM. So all those little things that usually are easier, it makes it really hard. So yeah, totally having somebody as a mentor to help guide you through this process of getting out, even just having somebody to talk to is a great idea. And that's something we were really trying to strive to do.
All right, so we have time for, you know, one or two more questions. If there's anyone who has any questions for Skye or Adan. Yeah, Tom, I saw you on mute.
Shaylin, yeah, not a question. I just wanted to point out that we've had a number of people speak from the Friends of Long Creek, of which I'm also a board member, and many people may not be aware that we have a website, and it's simply friendsoflongcreek.org. And I would encourage everyone to just go check it out. It's a pretty simple site. You'll get a better understanding of what our mission is. It has been very well laid out by other speakers today, but you can read and get some more detail. And if you were looking for ways to help kids and you wanted to, I'm not trying to shill here, but you can donate to the Friends of Long Creek, and we put that money, 100% of it, into providing items and tools and supplies and various clothing and personal items to the kids in there. It's a direct pipeline to them.
Thank you, Tom. Shaylin, did you have a question as well? I think you're muted.
Can you hear me now?
Yes.
Okay. All right. I was hoping, or just wondering if you guys could provide some more details on what the community-based alternatives would look like. Like, what would the day in the life of a child in one of these community based alternatives that you've been talking about look like?
Yeah, so I think it can look like a couple different things. I think right now we're trying to create the programs because there's not really a lot in the community now. But it's like kind of having more opportunities to do housing. I wish I had more information on it. Like, it's really brand new. That's a lot of that we're talking about, but essentially cover all the basics of like housing, job opportunities. So having somebody help you, like people that can, jobs that can help you, like, you know, their backgrounds and stuff like that, to be able to transition into that, into the community. So different programs. So like something with mental health, having counselors who are there in the background, that's not just decided by the Department of Corrections. I think, you know, like all these, like finding food, shelter, all these different things. But I think with the programs, we'll have more information coming up. Sorry, that's more of the advocacy section. So I do the organizing more, and I should have more information on it, but we're going to be posting what those will look like. But I think it's like in the very new process of the pilot program on that information on there. But if you want, I'll send over some information when I talk to them, to Brendan, and I can have them send out information that I find out as well. That'll be helpful. And I'll send over the other links I was talking about because I couldn't find them right now. I'll make sure all the things I was saying will get sent over so he can give it on an email. And Adan, I don't know if.
I'll give him my idea if y'all don't steal it. But I was thinking like a credible messenger, like someone who is, has been in the community, someone who's been to Long Creek, and someone that has been in the system before as well. It's like, say, like as a kid, I had like a counselor. Was it a counselor? But it was like a social worker where I would meet with them consistently throughout the week. We'd have a certain time we'd meet. It would be like 2 times a day. So like either these people would help me, you know, get my phone, pay my bills, do my homework, go to sports, you know, make sure that I wasn't late to practice, make sure that I wasn't late to school, make sure that I was coming home during my curfews, making sure that I was going to do my probation piss test, because I was doing it for like 2 years. So it's like someone that's right there next to you, you know, that's been there and done that before. And it's like, one thing I say is it creates more jobs. Another thing I say is like it brings the community together, where the community is actually working on those that have been part of the community, including those young folks. And then I say it has an age limit, you know, like we would have folks that would get educated on these things, go to school for these things, and then, you know, be implemented into these jobs where they're actually being a hands-on supportive person, where it's like instead of isolating and all that, you say like a bird, you know, you let it go free and you let it find what it's supposed to be good at, and you let it find the exact thing that it's looking for. But there's somebody along the way that's holding the hand and helping them. I know there's money all over the place, you know what I'm saying? And I know there's folks that, you know, I've been incarcerated, I've gone to college, you know, very educated, but don't have the opportunities to help others. And I feel like those folks can be recycled, and they could help those folks that are stumbling along the way. I think that that would be a good example of like a community-based alternative, but we don't want to talk about it.
Great, thank you. Well, I think that should about do it. Before we say our thank yous, Skye, Adan, do you give you a chance for last word? Anything you want to highlight, reinforce? Any final comments?
Yeah. I just want to say thank you guys for coming on and, you know, listening to this. I know that there's been other speakers, and it, especially with like Randy and everything. So there's a lot of different areas of like how you're getting information from this. But again, it's up to you on how you want to perceive the information and educate yourself on it. And I just say the best information is always just having conversations with different people and creating your own analysis of it. And really just looking up the data and the hard facts of what's actually going on. Because I think people can have opinions on it a different way. But I think, you know, data speaks for itself and experience speaks for itself as well. And I think, you know, that's the best way to do it. And if you want to do more, we're always open to have more conversation and, you know, do something like this again, where we can, you know, provide more information or different ways to get involved. So, yeah, thank you.
Let's give our speakers a big thank yous and applause. You know, it was a great event, and I look forward to the next one.